Hi, here in this question we are given that the sides AB and CD of a trapezium ABCD are parallel. So there is a trapezium, the side AB is the smaller side. So there is a trapezium ABCD, this is let's say the trapezium, side AB is the smaller side and ABCD are the parallel sides. Okay, now P is a point, midpoint of CD, fine, this is a point P here. P is the midpoint of CD and ABPD is a parallelogram. Okay, great. So ABPD. Now this here becomes a parallelogram. That means this side is parallel to this side and this side is parallel to this side over here. Okay? If the difference between the areas of parallelogram ABPD and triangle BPC, okay, the difference between area of this parallelogram and triangle BPC, this triangle, this difference is 10. Then the area in square centimeter of the trapezium ABCD is how much? Okay, fine. Now let's do one thing. Let's draw the diagonal AP for the what do you say? For the parallelogram ABPD. Now we know in a parallelogram the diagonal divides the parallelogram in two equal halves, right? So if this is x, this will also be equal to x over here, right? This will also be x. Also, we know that if a triangle and a parallelogram have the same base and the same height, area of parallelogram will be twice the area of triangle. If you look at this parallelogram ABPD and the triangle BPC, their bases are equal. DP is equal to PC. The base is equal, right? Area of a parallelogram is base into height. Area of a triangle is half base into height. Right? So for this triangle and for this parallelogram, base is same, DP and PC. P is the midpoint. And height is also same. This is the height. That means area of this triangle will be half the area of parallelogram. So instead of drawing this diagonal also, we can simply say, if the area of triangle is x, area of the parallelogram will be twice of x, right? And the question says the difference in this area, 2x minus x, is 10. That means x is equal to 10. So the area of this triangle is 10, area of the parallelogram is 20, hence the total area of the trapezium is 20 plus 30. We have to figure out the total area of trapezium, which comes out to be 20 plus 30. Right? Hence the answer is option B here. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. Here in this question, we are given that we are asked the number of ways of distributing 15 identical balloons, 6 identical pencils, and 3 identical erasers amongst 3 children such that each child gets at least 4 balloons and 1 pencil. Okay. So let's see the Let's calculate the number of ways of distributing 15 balloons, the number of ways of distributing 6 pencils, and the number of ways of distributing 3 erasers. Right? So the number of ways of distributing 15 balloons such that each child gets 4 balloons. So 15 balloons, let's say first child gets B1 balloons, second gets B2 balloons, and the third gets B3 balloons. Right? So B1 plus B2 plus B3 should be equal to 15 balloons. Now we have to give at least 4 balloons to each of the children, right? So let's give 4 chocolate 4 balloons to each of these children. So finally we will be left with 4 plus 4 plus 4, 12. 15 minus 12 is 3. Now we are left with only 3 balloons and effectively we have to distribute these 3 balloons amongst the 3 children, right? B1, B2 and B3. So it doesn't matter which 4 balloons are given to which child because all the balloons are same. So effectively we have to distribute 3 objects, similar objects to 3 different groups, amongst 3 different groups. 3 identical objects among 3 different groups. Now we know a number of ways of distributing n identical objects in r different groups. In R different groups is n plus R minus 1 C R minus 1, right? So applying the same concept over here, number of ways of distributing 3 identical objects in three different groups. Is 3 plus 3 minus 1? C3 minus 1. So this becomes 5C2, which is 10 ways. So the number of ways of distributing 15 balloons such that each child gets at least 4 balloons is 10 ways. Now, doing the same thing for pen, now let's say the first child gets P1 pen, the second gets P2, and the third gets P3 pens. Now we have to give at least one pencil. Sorry, this is pencil, not pen. Pencil. Each child gets at least one pencil. So out of 6, if we have already given 3 pencils, so we are left with 3 pencils which effectively have to be distributed amongst 3 children, right? So again, it's pretty much same as what we had to do for balloons. 3 identical pencils to be given to 3 different children. The number of ways is 3 plus 3 minus 1, C3 minus 1, which is effectively 5C2, which is again 10 over here, right? And finally, coming to erasers. Now, there is no condition on erasers. Any number of erasers can be given to any child, right? So, 3 erasers have to be given to 3 children. So, the condition is again same as we did for balloons and for pencils. 3 identical objects to be distributed amongst 3 different groups. The number of ways is 3 plus 3 minus 1, C3 minus 1, which is again 5C2, which is 10 here, okay? Therefore, the total number of ways is, there are 10 ways to distribute balloons, 10 ways to distribute pencils, and 10 ways to distribute erasers. So the total number of ways is 10 into 10 into 10, which comes out to be 1000. Hence, the final answer is 1000 ways here. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So this is a very beautiful question here. We are given these two equations and we have to figure out the value of x minus y. Now mind you, probably it's not possible to calculate the values of x and y individually here, but we can definitely calculate the value of x minus y here, right? How to do that? Simply add both these equations. So what we'll have is x square plus y square. So we have x square plus y square minus xy gives us minus 2xy. Then we have minus x and plus y. So we have minus x plus y is equal to, on the right hand side, we will have 22 plus 34, which is 56. Okay. So now if you concentrate on these three terms, this is effectively x minus y whole square. Right. And if we take minus common from these two terms, we have minus times of x minus y, which is equal to 56 here. Now, if you look at these two terms here, we can simply take x minus y common. So from here, we will be left with x minus y. And from here, we will be left with minus 1. So this gives us 56. So we have 56, which is effectively written as a product of a number into a number minus 1. So if x minus 1 is, let's say, a, so we have a into a minus 1 is equal to 56, right? Now, can you write 56 as a product of a number and one less than that number? The only way to do that is 8 into 7, right? The only way to write 56 as a product of a number and the number less than the previous number is 8 into 7. That means the value of a is 8. A, which is x minus y, is equal to 8 here. Hence, the answer is option A, 8. Okay? So, that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So, a very, very straightforward question here we have. From a container filled with milk, 9 liters of the milk is drawn and replaced with water. So, this is the first replacement. 9 liters is taken out and replaced with water. Next, from the same container, 9 liters are again drawn and replaced with water. Okay. If the volume of milk and water in the container are now in the ratio of 16 is to 9. Initially, the container only had milk. Initially, there was only milk. And finally, what we had was milk and water in the ratio of 16 is to 9. That means milk is 16 by 25th of the total volume. Right? This is going to be the volume of milk. Milk is going to be 16 by 20. 16 by 16 plus 9. 16 by 25th of the total volume. Then we have to calculate the capacity of the container here. Okay, very straightforward question. Let's say the capacity of the container is V liters. Now, out of V liters, 9 liters are being drawn out. Okay, so the fraction of milk that is being drawn out is 9 by V. This is the fraction that is taken out. So the fraction remaining is 1 minus 9 by V. So let's say initially the container's volume is V. The quantity of milk initially was V. So out of this V liters, 9 by V fraction is taken out. So the fraction remaining will be 1 minus 9 by V times of V. This is the volume of milk remaining after first replacement. Now, volume of milk remaining after the second replacement will be how much? Again, 9 by V or 9 liters are drawn out. That means the fraction that is drawn out is 9 by V again. So again, out of this total volume, again, the fraction remaining will be 1 minus 9 by V. Hence, the volume remaining will be 1 minus 9 by V whole square, right? This is same as 16 by 25th of the total volume. So this is 16 by 25 times the total volume V. So V and V gets cancelled out. From here we have 1 minus 9 by V is square root of 16 by 25, which is 4 by 5. So we have 1 minus 4 by 5 is 1 by 5, which is equal to 9 by V. Hence, V is equal to 5 into 9, 45 liters here. Since 9 was in liters, V also comes out to be in liters. Hence, the answer to this question is 45 liters. Straightforward question, right? If you remember the formula, that's also, you can directly apply the formula. The volume of the quantity that is being diluted, here it is milk, volume of milk, finally, final volume of milk, is initial volume of milk into 1 minus the amount that is being replaced divided by total quantity raised to the power number of replacements. Here n is equal to 2, r is equal to 9, v is what we need to calculate. This is v and this is 16 by 25 times of v. Okay, so that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi, so here again we have a pretty straightforward sort of question. There are two trains A and B. They're moving in opposite directions and the ratio of their speeds is 5 is to 3. So let's say this is train A whose speed is 5s and there is another train B whose speed is 3s. Now the front end of A, this is what we are talking about. Front end of A crossed the rear end of B. That means this part here. 46 seconds after the front ends of the train have crossed each other. So this is their starting position. This is where the front end of A has just crossed the front end of B. And after this, it takes 46 seconds for the front end of A to cross the rear end of B. Okay. So time taken 46 seconds is equal to the distance. Now this distance is same as length of train B, which is let's say B, divided by their relative speed. Now the relative speed will be 5s plus 3s since they're moving in opposite direction. So this is 8 into s. That means the length of train B is 46 into 8s. This is length of train B, right? Okay. Now the next part of the question says it took another 69 seconds for the rear ends of the train to cross each other. Okay. So another 69 seconds, that means once the front end of A has crossed the rear end of B, after that 69 seconds. So instead of doing so many cases, let's just say it takes 69 plus 46. That means 115 seconds for the rear ends to cross each other from this starting position. From this starting position, it takes 115 seconds for the rear ends to cross each other. So 115 seconds is, now the length should be the sum of the two lengths A plus B divided by the relative speed, which will again be 5s plus 3s, which is 8s. So from here we have A plus B is equal to 115 into 8s. Okay, cool. So if B is this and A plus B is this, the value of A is 115 into 8s. Minus B is 46 into 8 s. So 8s is common. We have 115 minus this is 46, which is 69 into 8s. This is the length of a. Finally, what we need to do is we need to calculate the ratio of the lengths of a and b. So length of a is 69 into 8s, and that of b is 46 into 8s. So you can see 8s gets cancelled out. We have 69 ratio 46 over here. Okay, so from here we can see that the common factor here is 23. So 69 goes by 23 three times and 46 goes by 23 two times. So the final ratio is 3:2. Hence the correct answer is option B, 3:2 over here. Okay, so that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So here in this question, we have a player in a football tournament. A player has played a certain number of matches. So let's say he has already played X number of matches. Now 10 more matches are to be played. If he scores a total of one goal over the next 10 matches, his overall average will be 0.15 goals per match. On the other hand, if he scores a total of 2 goals over the next 10 matches, his overall average will be 0.2 goals per match. The number of matches that he has played is how many? Okay. So let's say he has already scored G number of goals in the tournament so far. In the X games, he has already scored G number of goals. Fine. Now, G is the number of goals that he has scored in the first X matches. And if he scores one more goal over the next 10 matches, his overall average will be 0.15. So total number of goals G plus 1 will be overall average into total number of matches, which is X plus 10 over here. Right? Let's call this as the first equation. This is in the first case if he scores only one goal in the next 10 matches. But if he scores two goals over the next 10 matches, his average will be 0.2. That means initial number of goals, which is G, plus two new goals is the new average 0.2 into the total number of matches, which is again X plus 10, which is 2 over here. Now, simply subtracting the first equation from second equation, we have left hand side will be 1, which is equal to X plus 10 into 0.2 minus 0.15. This is 0.05 over here. So 20 is equal to X plus 10. That means X is equal to 10 over here. X is simply 10 over here. Okay. So your answer here is 10. Now you could have also directly calculated this equation by simply applying logic. Because of one goal difference, here we have one goal and here we have two goals. Because of this one goal difference, the average changes from 0.15 to 0.2. That means average increases by 0.05. For how many matches? For X plus 10 matches. For X plus 10 matches, the average increases by 0.05, which is due to one goal. Hence, X plus 10 is 1 upon 0.05, which is 20. Hence, X is equal to 10. You could have done this up by applying this simple logic as well. So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So again, we have a sitter sort of question. If you have the rules of logs very clearly, if you understand the rules of logs very clearly, this is a sort of sitter question. So what we have is log of some number in base 2 minus 2 is 0. Okay. So this is simply log of 2. Now this whole number, let's say this is capital X, is equal to 2. That means X is equal to 2 raised to the power 2, which is 4. What is X? This is X over here. So we have 3 plus log of 3y. Let me call this part as y. So 3 plus log of y base 3 is equal to 4. That means log of y base 3 is 1. 3 goes that side, 1. That means y is equal to 3 raised to power 1, which is 3. Okay. What was y? This is y. So we have 4 plus log of 4 z base 4. Let's call this as z. So log 4 plus log of z base 4 is 3. Right? So from here we have log of z base 4, which is equal to minus 1. That means z comes out to be 4 raised to the power minus 1, which is 1 by 4. What is that? That is x minus 1. So x minus 1 is 1 by 4, hence x is equal to 1 plus 1 by 4, which is 5 by 4. So the value of x comes out to be 5 by 4. But we are asked what is the value of 4x. So 4 times of x will be 4 times of 5 by 4, which is 5. Hence the answer to this question is 5. Very simple question. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So this is a question based on successive percentage change. Raj invested 10,000 rupees in a particular fund. At the end of first year, he incurred a loss. So let's say the loss is P%. He incurred a loss. So the value at the end of first year will be 10,000 into 1 minus P by 100. Okay. So this is going to be his balance at the end of first year, which the question says is more than 5,000. So this balance should be more than 5,000 rupees. We will have to keep this in mind. Okay. Now this balance when invested for another year, so this balance when again invested for another year, it grows in the second year, which is 5 times the percentage of loss in the first year. The growth in the second year was 5 times the percentage loss in the first year. That means it grows by 5p%. So the value of this amount when it grows 5p% will be 10,000 into 1 minus p by 100 into 1 plus 5p by 100. This is going to be the value at the end of second year, such that the overall growth, if the gain of Raj from the initial investment over the 2-year period is 35%, that means the overall growth is 35%. That means this amount should be equal to 10,000 into 1 plus 35 by 100. Simple, right? So what you can do is you can equate both these values here now. So you have 10,000 into 1 minus p by 100 into 1 plus 5p by 100 is equal to 10,000 into 1 plus 35 by 100. Okay, so 10,000, obviously 10,000 gets cancelled out. So once you multiply this, what we will get is 5p minus p minus 5p into p upon 100 is equal to 35. This is what you will get. Now you could have arrived at this equation directly also if you remember the formula for successive percentage change, right? If an amount grows by a percent and b percent successively, or changes rather, instead of growing, let me say changes by a percent and b percent successively, that means the overall percentage change is a plus b plus a into b upon 100. So a here is minus p percent and b here is 5p%. And the overall percentage change, this is overall percentage change, overall percentage change is 35%, which is given to us. Okay, so let's try to simplify this now. 5p minus p is 4p, 4p into 100 is 400p. Minus 5p square is 3500. So this goes 5p square minus 400p plus 3500 is equal to 0. So dividing by 5, we have p square minus 80p plus 700 is equal to 0. So once you solve this, obviously p is either 10 or 70. The value of p will be either 10 or 70. Now, if p is 70%, this value here comes out to be 10,000 into 1 minus 70%. This comes out to be 3,000. But this cannot be the case because the final amount has to be more than 5,000 rupees. That means the value of p is 10% and not 70%. So the answer here is option A, 70%. Oh, sorry, 10%. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So here in this question, we are given that for a sequence of numbers, real numbers, x1, x2, so on till xn, x1 minus x2 plus x3 minus x4 and so on is n square plus 2n for all natural numbers n. Then what is the sum of x49 plus x50? Okay. So the best way of doing this question is by simply substituting the values of n as 1, 2 and 3 and so on. And let's see what is the pattern. If n is equal to 1, we have only x1 here. Okay. x1 is equal to 1 square plus 2n, which is 3. Great. Now if n is equal to 2, we have x1 minus x2, which is equal to 2 square plus twice of 2, which is 4 over here. Sorry, 4 plus 4, 8 over here. Right? That means if this is the case, sorry, and x1 is 3, if we substitute x1 as 3 over here, so x2 comes out to be minus 5. So x1 is 3 and x2 is minus 5. Now if we substitute n is equal to 3, we have x1 plus x2, sorry, x1 minus x2 plus x3, which is equal to 3 square is 9 plus twice of 3 is 6. 9 plus 6 is 15. Okay? So from here we can calculate x3. X1 minus x2 is 8, 15 minus 8 is 7. So x3 is 7. Let's do it just one more time and we will be able to clearly see the pattern. If n is 4, we have x1 minus x2 plus x3 minus x4 is equal to 4 square is 16, 16 plus 8 is 24. Okay, so from here x1 minus x2 plus x3 is 15. This we can already see. Hence x4 is 15 minus 24. So x4 is minus 9 over here. Now, so we can clearly see that the numbers are actually, if you ignore the sign, x1, x2, x3, x4, these are consecutive odd numbers and the sign is alternatively plus, minus, plus, minus here, right? So we can see that xn, this is the second odd number. So this is, we can say this is 2 into 1 plus 1, right? 2 into 1 plus 1. This is 2 into 2 plus 1, if we only see the value and not the sign. So xn will be 2 into n plus 1. This is going to be the value. Now what is going to be the sign? Now sign is, if x of an odd number is, if we have an odd number here, the sign is positive, and if we have an even number, the sign is negative here, right? So this is again, if x of an odd number, then the sign is positive. If x of an even number, then the sign is negative. So this is n plus 1. X of n is minus 1 to the power n plus 1 into twice of n plus 1. Okay? Cool. So x of 49 is going to be minus 1 raised to the power 50, which is going to be a plus. So twice of 49 plus 1. And x of 50 is going to be minus 1 raised to the power 51, which is going to be a negative sign, twice of 50 plus 1. So once we add both these numbers, x of 49 plus x of 50 is equal to, this is 98 plus 1, 99. This is 100 plus 1, 101, minus 101. So 99 minus 101 is minus 2. Okay, so this is minus 2 over here. So the final answer is option A, minus 2. So that's it for this question. Thank you. Okay, so here we have a slightly tricky question. This is a slightly difficult question. We have Anil, Bobby and Chintu. They jointly invest in a business and agree to share the overall profit in proportion to their investments. Fine. Pretty normal question so far. Anil's share of investment is 70%. Great. So Anil's investment is 70%. This is investment breakup. His share of profit decreases 420 rupees if the overall profit goes down from 18% to 15%. So we don't know the total investment. So let's say the total initial investment is I. If the profit goes down from 18 to 15%, that means there is a decrease of 3%. There's a decrease of 3% of the investment. Profit is generally calculated on investment, right? So the decrease in investment is 3% of I. That means 3i by 100. Now, out of this decrease, the decrease for Anil would be 70% of this, right? Total profit decreases 3%, but for Anil, the amount will decrease by 70% of this 3%. So decrease in the profit of Anil will be 70% of this, which the question says is equal to 420 rupees over here. Okay, so from here we can see that the value of investment comes out to be 20,000 rupees. That means the total investment is 20,000 rupees here. Okay. Now again, we are also given the same data for Chintu. Chintu's share of profit increases by 80 rupees if the overall profit goes from 15 to 17%. Now the profit is increasing by 2% of the initial investment. So profit increases by 2i by 100. Now obviously Chintu will not get the whole increase in profit. Chintu will get only C percent. Let's say Chintu's investment is C percent. Since the profit is divided in the ratio of their investments, if the Chintu's investment is C percent, his profit share will also be C percent. So Chintu will receive C percent of this total increase, which the question says is equal to 80 rupees. Okay. So here, substituting the value of 20,000, we have 2 into 20,000 into C upon 100 into 100 is 10,000, which is equal to 80. So this goes 2 times, 2 into 2 is 4, this becomes 20. That means C is 20%. Chintu's investment is 20%. If Chintu's investment is 20%, what will be Bobby's investment? 70 plus 20 is 90. So Bobby's investment will be 10%. 100 minus 90 is 10%. Since total investment was 20,000 that we calculated here, hence Bobby's investment will be 10% of 20,000, which is 2,000 rupees. Okay, so the answer to this question is option A, 2,000 rupees. So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So here in this question, we are given that for all possible integers n satisfying this particular condition, where 2 plus 2 raised to power n plus 2 should be less than or equal to 202 and more than or equal to 2.25, the number of integral values of 3 plus 3 raised to power n plus 1 is how many? So let's take this. So from here we can say 2 raised to power n plus 1 should be less than or equal to 202 minus 2, or it should be greater than or equal to 2.25 minus 2. That means 2 raised to the power n plus 2 should be less than or equal to 200 but greater than or equal to 0.25 over here. Okay, fine. So let's consider this part here. 2 raised to power n plus 1, n plus 2 should be less than or equal to 200, right? Now what can be the maximum value of n such that 2 raised to power n plus 2 is less than or equal to 200? We know 2 raised to power 7 is 128 and 2 raised to power 8 is 256, right? So this value here, n plus 2, should be less than or equal to 7. It cannot be 8. Hence n plus 2 should be less than or equal to 7. Hence n should be less than or equal to 5. The maximum value that n can take is 5. Remember, n has to be a integer, right? Next is, let's take this. 0.25 we know is 1 by 4, which is 2 raised to power minus 2. Okay, so now 2 raised to power n plus 2 has to be greater than or equal to 2 raised to power minus 2. That means n plus 2 has to be greater than minus 2. That means n has to be greater than or equal to minus 4. So basically n can take any value from minus 4 till 5. Minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. N can take any of these values, but the question is not simply the value of n. We have to find integral value of this part. Now 3 is always an integer. This number should also be an integer. For what value of n will 3 raised to power n plus 1 be an integer? So for 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, there is absolutely no problem. 3 raised to power 0 or 1, 2, 3, all are integers. What if n is equal to minus 1? If n is minus 1, this becomes 3 raised to the power 0, which is 1, which is also an integer. So this will also do. But will minus 2 work for us? Let's see. If we substitute n minus 2, this becomes 3 raised to the power minus 1, which is 1 by 3, which is not an integer. Hence, minus 2, minus 3, as well as minus 4 will not be the values that we can substitute here for this to be an integer. Hence the number of values is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there are 7 values of n for which this expression is an integer. Remember, there are 10 integral values of n, but that's not the answer. There are 7 values of n for which this expression is also an integer. Okay, so that's it for this question. Thank you. Okay, so here we have For a real number x, the condition that 3x minus 2 mod minus 20 mod plus mod of 3x minus 40 is equal to 20 necessarily holds if which of these options is true. Okay, so if this is true, which of these options is true? This is what we have to figure out. Okay, fine. So here let's take three different ranges where 3x is greater than 40, greater than equal to 40, where 3x is less than 40 but greater than or equal to 20, and where 3x is less than 20. Okay, 3x is less than 20. Fine. If 3x is greater than 40, this is also positive, this is also positive. So we'll have 3x mod will be simply 3x minus 20, and mod of 3x minus 40 will be simply 3x minus 40. Since both these terms are positive, this is equal to 20. So we have 6x minus 60 is 20. So we have 6x is equal to 80, hence the value of x is 80 by 6, which is 40 by 3, which is 13.33. So the value of x here comes out to be 13.33, which is actually fine because what we assumed was 3x should be greater than 40. That means we assumed x should be greater than or equal to 40 by 3, which is 13.33. So we assume that x should be greater than or equal to 13.33, and we get the value of x as exactly 13.33. So this is acceptable value here. Okay. Now let's look at this range here. So here we assume that 3x is less than 40. That means obviously x is less than 13.33, but it should be greater than or equal to 20 by 3, which is 6.67. So x is greater than or equal to 6.67 but less than 13.33. Now if this is the case, this expression here will be positive, no problem with this, but this expression here will be negative. If 3x is less than 40, this expression will be negative. Hence, if mod of a negative number is there, how will we simplify this? This will become minus 3x minus 40. And since 3x minus 20 is positive, we can simply open it as 3x minus 20. So 3x minus 20 minus 3x minus 40 should be equal to 20. So what will happen is plus 3x minus 3x gets cancelled out. We have plus 40 from here and minus 20. So this is 20 is equal to 20, which is actually always true. Since this is always true, we will accept this whole range as our answer. We will accept this whole range as our answer. Okay. So one answer we had was 13.33. Then we had this whole range, and finally let's look at this final range. So here what we are assuming is x should be less than 20 by 3, which is 6.67. x should be less than 6.67. If this is the case, what's going to happen is this expression is also going to be negative and 3x minus 40 is also going to be negative. So since 3x minus 20 is negative, so mod of 3x minus 20 will be minus 3x minus 20. And again, since 3x minus 40 is negative, so we can open this as minus 3x minus 40. This should be equal to 20 over here. So minus 3x minus 3x is minus 6x. Plus 20 plus 40 is plus 60, which is equal to 20. So we have minus 6x is equal to minus 40. Hence the value of x is 20 by 3, which is 6.67. Okay. Now, since we have assumed x to be less than 6.67, we can reject this answer so far. Okay. So finally, what we are getting is we are getting this range as our answer and exactly 13.33. So we can say, combining these two answers, we can say that x should be less than or equal to 13.33, but greater than or equal to 6.67. This is going to be our complete answer, complete range of x. X should be less than equal to 6.67 but greater than or equal to 13.33. Now let's check which of these options is correct. If we take option A, now option A says x should be greater than 6, but is it necessary that x is greater than 6 if we take the value of x as 6.1? But x equals to 6.1 does not lie in our answer range, in our actual answer, because x has to be greater than 6.67. x cannot be equal to 6.1. So this is not the correct range. Now x should be less than 14 if we check the second option. less than 14, if we take x as 13.9, is 13.9 in our range? No, 13.9 is not in our range. X should be less than 13.33. It cannot be equal to 13.9. So this is also not going to satisfy the actual answer. Similarly, this range is also not going to satisfy the answer because x has to be less than 13.33 and not less than 15. If you take x equals to 14, x equals to 14 lies in this range, but that it x equals to 14 does not lie in our actual answer range, right? Same is the case for all these three options A, B, C. Here, 6.1 lies in this range, but it does not lie in our actual answer. Hence, we rejected option A. X equals to 13.9, it lies in option B, but 13.9 does not lie in our actual answer range. Same is the case for option C. But if you look at option D, any value which is there in option D range is also there in our actual answer range. Hence, the correct answer is option D here. Option D is the correct answer here. Although this is not an exhaustive range, mind you, this is not an exhaustive range. This is a sub range of or subset of what the actual answer is. This is only a subset of what the actual answer is. Okay. So that's it for this question. Thank you. Okay. So now coming to this question, here we have, suppose one of the roots of this quadratic equation is 2 plus root 3, where a, b, c are rational numbers and a is not equal to 0, and it is also given that b is equal to c cube, then we have to figure out the value of mod of a. Fine. Now we know when the coefficients of a quadratic equation are rational, then the roots are always in conjugate pairs. If one of the roots is 2 plus root 3, the other root will definitely be 2 minus root 3. Roots of a quadratic equation exist in conjugate pairs if the coefficients are all rational. Hence, sum of the roots will be 2 plus root 3 plus 2 minus root 3, 4, and product of the roots will be 2 plus root 3 into 2 minus root 3, which is 2 square minus root 3 square, which is 1. So from here we can say sum of the roots is, which is 4, is minus the coefficient of x divided by coefficient of x square. So from here we have b is equal to 4 times of a, right? Also, product of the roots, which is 1, is equal to the constant term divided by coefficient of x square, which is a. So c is equal to a over here. Fine. So we are also given that b is equal to c cube. B is equal to c cube. So instead of b, we can substitute 4a. And instead of c, we can substitute a cube. So from here, 4 is equal to a square. That means a is equal to plus minus 2. A is plus minus 2, but since we are asked the value of mod a, so mod of a will be, mod of plus 2 will also be 2, and mod of minus 2 will also be 2. Hence, the answer will be option a, 2 only. So the answer to this question is option a, 2. So that's it for this question. Thank you. Okay. So here in this question, we have two pipes A and B. They are attached to an empty water tank. Pipe A fills the tank while pipe B drains it. So A is filling and pipe B is draining. Okay. If pipe A is opened at 2 p.m. Okay. So let's draw the timeline. At 2 p.m. pipe A is opened and pipe B is opened at 3 p.m. So after 3 p.m. both of them are working, A plus B. Now the tank gets full at 10 p.m. The tank is full at 10 p.m. Fine. Instead of this whole timeline, instead if pipe A is opened at 2 p.m. Instead if pipe A is opened at 2 p.m. and pipe B is opened at 4 p.m. So after 4 p.m. both of them are working. Now the tank becomes full at 6 p.m. Tank is full at 6 p.m. If pipe B is not opened at all, then the time taken in minutes for the tank to fill is how much? Okay. So let's do one thing. Let's take efficiency of A's A units per minute or per hour, and B's efficiency as B units per hour. Negative here indicates that B is emptying the tank. Now in the first case, total work done is how much? Total work done by A in the first 1 hour is 1 into A. And work done by A and B in the next 7 hours is 7 times of A minus B. Hence, the total work done is 7a plus a is 8a minus 7b. This is the total work done in the first case. Now, total work done in the second case is a is working alone for 2 hours at an efficiency of a. A and b together are working for the next 2 hours, so twice of a minus b. So, the total work done in this case is 2a plus 2a, 4a minus 2b. Right? Now, since we are talking about the same tank in both these cases, that means the work done in both these cases will be same. Hence, 8a minus 7b is same as 4a minus 2b. So from here we have 4a is equal to 5b. Okay? So b or 4a is equal to 5b. This is what we have. Now let's calculate what is the actual total work to be done. So actual total work to be done is 4a minus 2b. So 4a minus 2b instead of 4a minus twice of b, and instead of b I can substitute this with 4a by 5. So this becomes 20 minus 12, which is 20 minus 8, sorry, 20 minus 8, just 12a by 5. This is the total work that has to be done. Even if you substitute b over here, 7 times of 4a by 5, so this is 40 minus 28, which is again 12a by 5. Obviously, work done is going to be same. So the final question here is, what is the time taken if b is not opened at all? Okay, if b is not opened at all, that means we have to effectively calculate the time taken by a. So the time taken by a will be work to be done, which is 12a by 5 units, divided by efficiency of a. So this comes out to be 12 by 5 hours. 12 by 5 hours is effectively 12 by 5 into 60 minutes, which is 12 into 12, 144 minutes. So time taken by A alone is 144 minutes, which is option C over here. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Now, coming to this question, here we have three positive integers x, y, and z are in arithmetic progression, and y minus x is greater than 2, and x into y into z is 5 times of their sum, then z minus x is what? Okay. Since the numbers are in arithmetic progression, so let's say the middle term is a and the common difference is d. So the value of z will be a plus d and the value of x will be a minus d. These are the three terms x, y, and z. Y minus x is nothing but the common difference, so d should be greater than 2, and z minus x is nothing but twice the difference, so we have to calculate the value of 2d, given that product of the numbers is 5 times their sum. So product of the numbers is a minus d into a plus d, which is equal to 5 times their sum, which is a plus, sorry, x plus y plus z. Okay, so we have a into a square minus d square is 5 times of 3a. Okay, so again a gets cancelled out. We have a square minus d square is equal to 15. A square minus d square is equal to 15 over here. Fine. Now, basically, what we need to do is we need to think of two numbers, the difference of whose squares will be 15. We have to think of two numbers such that the difference of their squares is 15. Okay? Or what else we can do is we can simply write a square minus d square is a plus d into a minus d, which is equal to 15. Now, since left-hand sides are integers, x and y are, x, y, z are integers. This is basically z and this is x. So left-hand side is written as a product of two integers. So let's see how can we write 15 as a product of two integers. Obviously, a plus d should be greater than a minus d over here because the difference is greater than 2. So either this is 15 into 1 or this is 5 into 3. Okay, a plus d can be 15 and a minus d is 1, or a plus d is 5 and a minus d is 3. If this is the case, if a plus d is 15 and a minus d is 1, that means a is 8. Sorry, not 8, 15 plus rather 16. Yeah, a is 8 and डी इज इक्वल टू 7, डी इज इक्वल टू 7, दैट मीन्स दी नंबर्स विल बी वन एक्स वाई जेड, एक्स वाई जेड विल बी 8 माइनस 7 वन, ए विच इज 8, एंड 8 प्लस 7 15, दीज आर गोइंग टू बी द नंबर्स, एंड द कॉमन डिफरेंस हियर इज ग्रेटर देन 2 विच इज 7, सो दिस इज फाइन, 7 इज ग्रेटर देन 2. नेक्स्ट पॉसिबिलिटी इज ए प्लस डी इज 5 एंड ए माइनस डी इज 3. इन दैट केस ए विल बी 5 प्लस 3 8/2, ए इज गोइंग टू बी 4 एंड डी इज गोइंग टू बी 1. सो हियर द वैल्यू ऑफ एक्स विल बी 3, दिस इज 4 एंड दिस इज 5, बट हियर द कॉमन डिफरेंस इज ओनली 1, द कॉमन डिफरेंस इज 1, बट कॉमन डिफरेंस हैज टू बी ग्रेटर देन 2, दैट मीन्स वी विल रिजेक्ट दिस पॉसिबिलिटी. सो द ओनली पॉसिबिलिटी इज ए इज 8 एंड डी इज 7, सो डी इक्वल्स टू 7 इज द ओनली पॉसिबिलिटी, एंड वी हैव टू कैलकुलेट द वैल्यू ऑफ ट्वाइस ऑफ डी विच इज गोइंग टू बी ट्वाइस ऑफ 7, 14. हेंस द आंसर टू दिस क्वेश्चन इज ऑप्शन सी, 14 ओवर हियर. ओके, सो दैट्स इट फॉर दिस क्वेश्चन, थैंक यू. ओके, सो हियर इन दिस क्वेश्चन वी आर गिवन दैट डी एंड ई बी द पॉइंट्स ऑन ए बी एंड ए सी रिस्पेक्टिवली ऑफ अ ट्राइंगल ए बी सी. ओके, सो दिस इज अ ट्राइंगल ए बी सी, दिस इज ए बी एंड सी. डी एंड ई, डी इज अ पॉइंट ऑन ए बी, सच दैट ए डी इज टू बी डी इज 2:1. डी इज अ पॉइंट हियर सच दैट दिस रेशियो इज 2:1. इफ दिस इज 2x, दिस इज एक्स हियर. ओके, ऑल्सो ई इज अ पॉइंट ऑन ए सी सच दैट ए ई इज टू सी ई इज 2:3. सो दिस, इफ दिस इज ई, दिस रेशियो इज 2:3. सो इफ दिस इज 2y, दिस इज 3y. ओके फाइन, इफ द एरिया ऑफ द ट्राइंगल ए डी ई, ओके सो ए डी ई, एरिया ऑफ दिस ट्राइंगल इज 8 स्क्वायर सेंटीमीटर्स, देन वॉट इज द एरिया ऑफ द ट्राइंगल ए बी सी. वी हैव टू कैलकुलेट एरिया ऑफ दिस एंटायर ट्राइंगल ए बी सी ओवर हियर. ओके फाइन, सो लेट्स ट्राई टू सॉल्व दिस. नाउ लेट्स डू वन थिंग, लेट्स जॉइन बी ई, लेट्स जॉइन बी ई ओवर हियर. ओके फाइन, इफ वी जॉइन बी ई, now if you look at triangle ADE and triangle DBE, okay, and if we draw a line parallel to AB from E, so you can see this triangle and this triangle, both these triangles are between the same parallel lines. Since they are between the same parallel lines, their height is going to be the same. This is going to be height for both the triangles, hence the ratio of their areas is going to be same as the ratio of their bases. Ratio of area is same as the ratio of their base. So if this is 8, this area is going to be 4. This area here is going to be 4. Okay? Since the ratio of their bases is 2:1 and height is same, the ratio of their areas will also be 2:1. So if this is 8, this is going to be 4 here. Fine. Now, let's focus on this triangle here, EBC, and the bigger triangle ABC. Sorry, not the triangle ABC, but the triangle ABE. Let me remove this now. Now, the area of this whole triangle is 8 plus 4, 12. Okay, so now if we look at this triangle and this triangle over here, again, if we draw a line parallel to AC from B, so this triangle and this triangle, they are again between the same two parallel lines, hence their height is going to be same. Since their height is going to be same, the ratio of their areas will again be same as the ratio of their bases. The ratio of their areas is going to be same as the ratio of their bases. So we have 12 upon A is same as 2:3. Hence the value of A here is 18. The area here is 18. Okay, so the total area of triangle ABC here comes out to be 12 plus 18, which is 30 square centimeter. Hence the answer to this question is 30 here. Fine, so that's it for this question. Thank you.
Hi,
So here in this question, we are given that if a rhombus has area 12 square centimeter and side length of 5 centimeter, then the length in centimeter of its longer diagonal is how much? Okay. So let's draw a rhombus. So this is rhombus. In a rhombus, we know all the four sides are equal. These will be the two diagonals. Okay, pardon the drawing. So this is a rhombus and we know all the four sides are equal. That means all four sides are 5 centimeter. Also in a rhombus, we know that the diagonals perpendicularly bisect each other. So this part will be equal to this part and this part will be equal to this part. Okay, so let's say this is x, so this will also be x, and if this is y, this will also be y over here. Okay, so area of the rhombus is given to us, which is 12 square centimeter. Now area of a rhombus is half of the product of the two diagonals, which is 2x into 2y, which is equal to 12 given to us. Okay, so 2 and 2 gets cancelled out. We have twice of x into y is equal to 12. This is the first thing. Okay, now if you look at this part here, this is a right angle triangle. Hence x square plus y square will be equal to 5 square, which is 25. Let's say this is first equation and this is the second equation. Okay, now if we add both these equations 1 plus 2, what we get is x square plus y square plus twice of x into y is 37. Hence we have x plus y whole square is 37. Hence x plus y is square root of 37. This is nothing but x plus y whole square, isn't it? Hence x plus y is root of 37. Also, if I subtract the first equation from second equation, I get x square plus y square minus twice of x into y is 25 minus 12, which is 13. So this gives me x minus y whole square is 13. Hence x minus y is square root of 13 here. Okay, let me call this as the fourth and the fifth equations, or third, fourth, whatever it is, let it be. So finally, what I need to calculate is, I need to calculate the longer diagonal here. I need to calculate the longer diagonal here. So how do we get the longer diagonal here? Simply add both these equations. So add the fourth and the fifth equation. We have twice of x is equal to root of 37 plus root of 13. This is when you add 4 and 5. If you subtract 4 and 5, if you subtract 5th from the 4th equation, we have twice of y is root of 37 minus root of 13, if you subtract. Now obviously you can see out of these two, 2x is the first diagonal, right? 2x is one of the diagonals, x plus x, this is one diagonal, and this is the other diagonal, 2y. Now out of these, obviously 2x is the bigger diagonal because there is a plus sign over here, whereas there is a minus sign over here. Hence the longer diagonal, which is 2x, is equal to root of 37 plus root of 13, which is option B over here. The correct answer is option B here. Okay, so that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi, now coming to this question, this is a slightly tricky question, you can say. We have to figure out the range of this function fx, which is x square plus 2x plus 4 upon 2x square plus 4x plus 9 here. Okay, so let's say f of x, which is y, is x square plus 2x plus 4 divided by 2x square plus 4x plus 9. One way of doing this question is basically cross multiplying and bringing all the terms on the left hand side. So you will have x square into 2y minus 1 plus x into 4y minus 2 plus 9y minus 4 is equal to 0. And now once you calculate the discriminant, since this is true for all real values of x, this is true for all real values of x, discriminant of this quadratic equation should be greater than or equal to 0. This is one way of doing this question, but this is going to be a very lengthy method. Instead of that, let's do one thing. Let's multiply this whole equation with 2. So your 2y is 2x square plus 4x plus 8 upon 2x square plus 4x plus 9. Why did I do this? I can see the coefficients here are half the coefficients here. Okay, that's why I'm doing this. Now the next thing that you can do is 2x square plus 4x plus. You can add one and subtract one over here. So we will have plus 9 minus 1 upon 2x square plus 4x plus 9 over here. So you have 2y is this quadratic upon this quadratic will give me 1 minus 1 upon the quadratic, my 1 upon 2x square plus 4x plus 9. So now what we have is we have simplified this whole expression into one single quadratic. Okay. And we have to figure out the maximum and the minimum value of the right hand side. Right. Now, when will we have maximum value of this whole expression? This whole expression will be maximum when this expression is minimum, and this expression will be minimum when this expression is maximum. Or in other words, y will be maximum when this expression is maximum, and y will be minimum when this expression is minimum here. Okay? So now let's calculate the maximum and the minimum value of this expression. Right. Now the maximum value of this expression will definitely be plus infinity, right? The maximum value will be plus infinity. That means the maximum value of y will be twice of y max will be 1 minus 1 upon infinity, which is effectively 0. So 1 minus 1 upon infinity, which is effectively 1. So that means y max will be 1 by 2. Now obviously, no equation can become infinity. So this will actually be an open bracket. So y will definitely be less than half. It will not be equal to half. It will definitely be less than half, right? Next is, let's calculate the minimum value of this expression. Now here you see that the discriminant is less than 0. B square 16 minus 4ac 72. This is less than 0. That means this graph will never become negative. This graph will always be above the x-axis. Coefficient of x square is positive and discriminant is less than 0. So this graph will always be positive. Okay, so the minimum value of this graph will be minimum at x equals to minus b by twice of a, twice of 2. So minimum will be when x is equal to minus 1. Hence, the minimum value of this expression is twice of minus 1 square plus 4 times of minus 1 plus 9. So this is minus 4 minus 2, 7. Minimum value of this expression is 7. That means twice the minimum value of y is equal to 1 minus 1 by 7, which is 6 by 7. Hence, the minimum value of y is 6 by 7 divided by 2, 3 by 7. Now, this will be a closed bracket because this quadratic can obviously attain the minimum value. It cannot attain the value infinite, but it will definitely attain the value of 7. Hence, y can be minimum y 3 by 7. So, y is definitely greater than or equal to 3 by 7 here. Okay? So, now if we combine both these equations or both these answers that we have, y is definitely greater than or equal to 3 by 7, but it is definitely less than half. Hence, the correct answer is option A over here. Y is greater than or equal to 3 by 7, but less than half. The correct answer is option A here. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So here in this question, we have a box has 450 balls, each either white or black. There being as many metallic white balls as metallic black balls. Okay, so the number of metallic white balls is same as the number of metallic black balls. Okay, so we have black and white balls, and there are certain metallic black balls and non-metallic black balls. Similarly, there will be certain metallic white balls and certain non-metallic white balls here. Okay. The number of metallic black balls is same as the number of metallic white balls. This is what is given. And the total number of balls is 450. This is also what we know. Okay, let's see what else is given. If 40% of the white balls and 50% of the black balls are metallic. So let's say the number of black balls is 100B and the number of white balls is 100W. So out of 100B black balls, 50% of the black balls are metallic. That means the number of metallic black balls is 50B and the remaining 50 will be non-metallic. So this will be 50B. Similarly, 40% of the white balls are metallic. Okay, that means 40% of 100W. 40W balls are white metallic balls, and the remaining 60%, 60W, is non-white or non-metallic, right? So now we know that this is equal to this over here. So we have 50 into B is equal to 40 into W. That means B by W is 4 ratio 5. The ratio of B and W is 4 is to 5. Hence, the total number of balls 100B plus 100W is 450. So we have 100B plus 100W is 450, total number of balls. So from here we have 100. B can be written as 4W by 5 from here, right? Plus 100W is equal to 450. So we have 100 by 5 is 20, 20 into 4 is 80, 80 plus 100 is 180. So we have 180W is equal to 450. That means the value of W is 45 by 18, which is, it goes by 9 5 times, it goes by 9 2 times, 5 by 2 is 2.5. So the number of white balls is 100 into, sorry, number of white balls is 100 into 2.5, which is 250. So this comes out to be 250. This is 250. Hence, the number of black balls will be 450 minus 250. That is 200. Okay. Now, finally, we have to calculate the number of non-metallic balls in the box. How many non-metallic balls are there? So the number of non-metallic balls will be 50% of 200. These are the black balls. So 50% of 200 is 100. And 60% of 250. 60% of 250 is 150. So the total number of non-metallic balls is 100 plus 150, that is 250. So the answer to this question is 250 here. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. Here in this question, we have for a four-digit number, the sum of its digits in the thousands, hundreds, and tens place is 14. Okay. So let's say the four-digit number is this. Okay, so here this is the units digit, this is the tens digit, this is the hundredths digit, and this is the thousandths digit. Okay, the question says sum of the thousand, hundreds, and tens places is 14. So sum of these three digits is 14. Also, the sum of the digits in hundredths and tens and units place is 15. Hundredths, tens, and units place. So sum of these three digits is 15 here. Okay, and the tens digit is 4 more than the units place digit. Tens digit is 4 more than units place digit. So if the units digit is x, tens digit will be x plus 4. Fine. Then the highest possible four digit such number is what? What is the highest possible such four digit number? Fine. So here, if you compare this sum versus this sum, these two digits are common in both the sums. The only difference is we have the thousands digit when the sum is 14 and we have the units digit when the sum is 15. Since because of this change of thousands and the units digit, sum is increasing by 1 unit or from 14 to 15. That means units digit is 1 more than thousands digit. That means the thousands digit will be x minus 1. This is going to be the thousandths digit over here, right? And we have no further information for the hundredths digit, so let's just leave that for the time being. Now we have to figure out the highest such possible number. Okay, so for this number to be the highest possible, the value of x should be highest here, right? Now, for x to be highest, if we just consider this digit, x can be 9 or x can be 10 also. But obviously x cannot be 10 because x has to be a single digit number, right? But if you consider this digit over here, the tens digit, Since x plus 4 has to be a single digit number, the highest possible single digit number is 9, hence the highest possible value of x is going to be 5. The highest possible value of x is 5. That means the highest possible value of the thousands digit will be 5 minus 1, 4. Highest possible value for the tens digit is going to be 5 plus 4, 9. And the highest possible value of units digit is going to be x, which is 5 here, right? And finally, what is the hundredth digit? We can simply calculate this by using the sum of the first three digits as 14, right? So 4 plus 9 is 13. The sum has to be 14. That means the hundredth digit has to be 1. So this becomes 4195. The highest such possible number is 4195 here. Okay? So that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi. So here in this question, we are given that a person buys tea of three different qualities, that is 800 rupee, 500 rupee and 300 rupees per kg. These are the prices of three different qualities. And the amount they are bought in is in the ratio 2:3:5. She mixes all these three kinds of teas and sells 1/6 of the mixture at 700 rupees per kg. The price in INR per kg at which she should sell the remaining amount to make an overall profit of 50% is. Okay. So what's happening here is there are three different varieties of teas, V1, V2 and V3. The price per kg of these three different varieties is 800 rupees per kg, 500 rupees per kg and 300 rupees per kg. Now the quantity that we are buying is in the ratio 2:3:5. So let's say we are buying 2 kgs, 3 kgs and 5 kgs. For simplicity, let's just assume 2, 3 and 5 kgs. Okay. So what will be the total cost? The total cost will be sum of three individual costs. So the cost of first variety is 800 into 2, which is 1600 rupees. For the third variety, it is 500 into 3, which is 1500. For the third variety, it is 300 into 5, which is again 1500. So the total cost comes out to be 3000 plus 1600, which is 4600 rupees. This is the total cost here, right? Now we want to earn a profit of 50% on the overall cost, right? We have to make an overall profit of 50%. That means the total selling price, of the whole, what is the total quantity that we bought? 2 plus 3 plus 5, which is 10 kgs. So the total selling price of this 10 kg should be 4600 into 1.5. We have to increase 4600 by 50%. So half of this is 23. So the total selling price will be 46 plus 23, which is 6900. This should be the total selling price here, right? Now, out of this total 10 kgs, what are we doing is we are selling 1/6 of this, yani 10 by 6 kgs, we are selling at the rate of 700 rupees per kg, right? So this TSP1, let's call this TSP1, the total selling price of this first part of T is 10 by 6 into 700, which is 7000 by 6. That means the total selling price of the remaining 5/6 of the quantity, 1/6 is being sold at 700 rupees, 5/6 is, let's say, being sold at P rupees per kg. So the total selling price of the remaining P rupees, or the remaining 5/6 quantity, will be 50 by 6 into P. This is the cost of the remaining amount of T. Now this total selling price should be equal to 6900 minus 7000, right? This should be 6900 minus 7000 by 6. Fine. So let's just solve this part here. We have 50p is equal to, let's multiply the whole equation with 6. So we'll have minus 7000 and we'll have 6 into 6900. Okay. So we can divide the whole equation by 10. So we have 5p is 6 into 690 minus 700. This comes out to be 0, 6, 9, 54, 36 plus 5, 41, 41, 40. -700 is 5p, so 5p here comes out to be 41 minus 71, which is 34. 31 3440. So p comes out to be 3440 divided by 5. Sorry, this should be divided by 5 here. So this 6 times 30, 488. So this comes out to be 688 rupees per kg. Hence the answer to this question is option B, 688 rupees per kg here. Okay, so that's it for this question. Thank you. Hi, so here in this question we are given that Anil can paint a house in 60 days. So Anil can do this in 60 days, whereas Vimal can paint it in 84 days. Okay. Anil starts painting and after 10 days, Vimal and Charu join him. Okay, so what's happening is, Anil starts working and he works for 10 days. After that, Vimal and Charu join him. Okay, together they complete the painting in 14 more days. So now, Anil, Vimal and Charu together take another 14 days to complete the whole work. This is the point where the work gets completed. If they are paid a total of 21,000 rupees for the job, then the share of Charu is how much? Now we know the payment should be done in the proportion of work done by them, right? So let's calculate what is the total work to be done and out of that, what is the work done by Charu? So let's say the work to be done, the total work to be done is LCM of 60 and 84 here, right? So 60 we know is 6 into 10 and so this should be LCM of 60 and 84. So 60 is 5 into 12 and 84 is 7 into 12, right? So the work to be done will be 5 into 7 into 12, which is 420 units. This is going to be the total work done. Now, efficiency of A will be 420 divided by 60, which is 7 units per day. And that of Vimal will be 420 by 84, which is 5 units per day. This is their efficiencies. So now let's focus here. The total work done in these 10 and 14 days should be 420 units. 420 units. This is work done by A in 10 days. A's efficiency is 7. So work done in 10 days is 7 into 10 plus work done by A, B and C in 14 days. So the efficiency of A and B is 7 plus 5, 12 plus efficiency of C, let's say C into 14. Fine? Okay. So this becomes 420 minus 70, which is 350, which is equal to 12 plus C into 14 here. So we have 12 plus C is equal to 350 by 14. 350 by 14. So this goes by 7. 50 times 2 times. This comes out to be 25. 25 is equal to 12 plus C. That means efficiency of C is 13 units per day. Efficiency of C is 13 units per day. That means work done by C. How much is it? C works for 14 days at an efficiency of 13 units per day. So work done is 13 into 14, which is 169 plus 13, 182 units. Work done by C is 182 units. So from here we can calculate fraction of work done by C is how much? 182 by 420 units. This is the fraction of work done by C. That means fraction of payment that C receives will also be 182 by 420. This is the fraction of payment that C will receive out of a total of 21,000. So into 21,000, right? So let's simplify this. 21 goes by 42 two times. So we have 1000 by 20. 1000 by 20 is 50. So we have 182 into 50, which is 9100. Hence, the payment that C receives is option A, 9100 here. Okay. So that's it for this question. Thank you.